experience music, it's always something that moves and that can move us in time. Yet when we come to look back at a piece, to talk about it, how difficult it feels to truly capture what's going on. How often it seems to me music is turned into a thing, something that is, rather than does. And this is because we leave time, music's medium, out of it. As I compose, the same thing can happen. Even as I'm projecting forward, trying to decide or feel what note comes next, I'm looking back at what I've already written. Somehow, I have to make one flow into the other. And yet, I'm also aware that sometimes sounds do fuse together as they move into a more static image. It depends on what I'm trying to make, what kinds of sound I want to shape in time, what kinds of time I want to shape in sound. Paul Clay famously talked about taking a line for a walk in his pedagogical sketchbook, and that's a good starting point as to how I shape notes. Only the line is sonority, and the canvas is a temporal one. Melody, harmony, and rhythm are, of course, the usual ways into talking about musical structure, but only when you start to consider the multiple nuances of a note's colour and weight, interlocked with its ebb and flow, will you start to get towards an understanding of how I think about music as I sit at my desk or piano. What do I mean by the weight of a sound? Every sound has a register, that is how high and low it is. There's the pressure a note takes in its attack, harsh or gentle. It has a richness or a lightness. It's profoundly affected by which instrument or group of instruments plays it. And then there's how long it lasts before moving on to another. The note might be alone, or more likely part of a larger phrase, line or flurry. All of these in combination are part of a note's weight. And its ebb and flow, well, of course, that has to do with rhythm, but there are many levels of rhythm, not only the foreground ones you hear. There's usually an unheard background beat against which the rhythm fits. And just as we enjoy the way poetry rides across its meters, so too are we enjoying the play of rhythm against musical meter. Or we may, in 20th and 21st century music, be challenged by the shifting of those meters themselves. And then there are other slower background patterns of phrase to phrase and between sections, like the rhythms of the day, perhaps, as opposed to minute ones. All these combine to keep the music steady, or push it faster forward, tightening, pressurising, or instead dilating, expanding, pulling back. The music waxes and wanes. Musical sound for me is more liquid than solid, then. And yet, as a composer of Western classical music, it's the solid-looking notes on the page that I have to deal with, to build from. And I very much do see my craft as a kind of building work, somewhere between a tiny handmade wooden box and an enormous building. I have to bake my bricks. I have to know how to lay them. I have to know how to join them together with well-prepared mortar, or they'll slip from each other. I need the design, the proportions of the whole to aim for, or my shape will be awkward, or the building, the musical work, may not stand up. That starts to sound very fixed. But that, for me, is part of music's fascination. It is at once architecture and flowing river. So far, most composers, I think, would recognise the way I've described my approach to composition. But now I want to talk in more personal terms. What are the sounds that I feel are individual to me and the way of handling them? Do I see my music as the sounds and nothing but the sounds? Or do I want them to be expressive of something outside them? Ideas, images, feelings, states of being. How do I see my music in relation to time? Before I keep going, I think we should now hear something of what I'm talking about. So here are the first 2 minutes of a piece for cello and piano, which I called Roseland. The title doesn't refer to the former New York City ballroom, but to a strip of land in Cornwall, remote and far from the hubbub of the city. When this piece was recently played at a concert in the US, listeners afterwards told me how much they were struck, in particular, by the unusual sound of the high, quiet cello. I was a little frustrated at first. What about the missed subtleties, the curves the music contains, the dynamic fluctuations, the way the cello sounds appear out of the piano attacks and disappear into the resonance, the movement in time, in other words? But then again, I precisely wanted to slow time down or break it up into little bits to replace a flowing time with a more suspended one. So perhaps it wasn't surprising then that the audience concentrated on something fixed, something held. And indeed, perhaps they had heard, without quite describing it, the way those bits were thought of by me as different views of the same object. Something like these two photographs, which I took of the Parthenon in Nashville, the US city where the concert took place. In what's often called the common practice period in the 18th and 19th centuries, musical harmony is said to progress in organic, developmental, directed forms. It's an appropriate idea for Beethoven or Brahms. But much changed in the 20th century, and it's far less appropriate for Debussy or Stravinsky, or now in the 21st century for me and for many others. Much better in Roseland, then, are the ideas of jump cuts and of focusing and refocusing on the same bit of musical material, reharmonized, recolored, one harmony giving way to another, one object with different lights shone upon it. And I'm especially interested in a particular version of this called enharmony, wherein the same note is spelt on the page and held in the musician's head in two different ways. An A sharp is the same sound as a B flat, but it's a different concept. A sharp fits within one scale or mode. B flat suggests a very different direction or colour. One looks sharp and pushing up, the other gentler and pulling back. They have different expressivities, different weights. One of the seminal examples of this is at the start of Debussy's prelude à l'après-midi d'un forme. Here, the first chord of the piece, in fact, it's Wagner's Tristan chord, but in a different voicing, it has an A sharp at the top of it, and then the A sharp is respelt, recoloured to become a B flat in the next chord, and the music turns to a different harmony, a suspended dominant seven. As G flat, it turns into an E flat minor chord with an added ninth, and then a D sharp turns into an E flat and a more open sonority, neither minor nor major. The music gently points upwards and downwards towards brightness and then softness. One image overlaps with the next, different views of the Parthenon or perhaps of haystacks. We should be careful about metaphors, of course. Music is just music, isn't it? But metaphors allow us access to things, and in a way we might otherwise not be able to converse about. And, well, music is not just music either. There are certain areas of our lives that it seems particularly adept at mirroring and engaging with. Longing, for instance, takes on musical apparel very well. Justice, rather less, though context might help. Chocolate would be problematic, though a feeling for chocolate might be possible. Emotion and mood are so commonly considered the stuff of music, and film, in particular, has exploited this so much that we're all incredibly well adept at reading musical signs in emotional terms. We know sad, jolly, desperate, agitated, triumphant, and so on. But perhaps we know them too well, so that when music does not appear to evoke definite feelings, it leaves many cold, even if for others it's purifying. Too often, I think, there's an either-or argument between the absolutists and expressives of music, and what's left out is the whole range in the middle, where most music, I think, sits, and not only from work to work, but within a single work. As I compose, I feel the connection to expression keenly, and at the very same time, a focus on the form, the rise and fall of the piece. And then there's something else. Sure, a pop song can try to fix itself on one mood, or a Baroque instrumental piece on one affect. But music can equally be, perhaps better, a map of the movement of feelings, the nuances of sadness, the give and take of emotion, the passage from one feeling to another, the drama between them. The notion of musical drama, by which I mean drama without words, has been a great release for many composers. It led to classical sonata form, it allowed musical works to grow enormously in size in the 19th century. The classic dramatic art of the exposition, rising action, climax, falling action, and denouement can all be perfectly recognised by the actions of music. And in the 20th century and beyond, drama has continued to be shaped in musical terms in so many other ways. Muted dramas, interior ones, fragmented ones, denouement, that is, non-resolution. In my Lost Worlds, the first piece of a set of seven with the overall title of Behofa, that I wrote as a commission for the BBC Symphony Orchestra, the drama is about time. Behofa is a real place, which for me symbolises an idea. It's a tiny hamlet in, again, Cornwall. In fact, it's on Roseland. where the road comes to a literal end, land meets sea. It's a very peaceful place. The work as a whole is a kind of working towards that serenity, but it's interrupted or disrupted by many bumps along the way. How is the serenity expressed? By action stopping, by rhythm stretching out, by note weight lightening. What are the bumps? A myriad of activities, of textural invention, of rhythmic thrust forward. Where is the drama in the relations between the two? The way the stops cut across the action, the way one thing gives way to or is overwhelmed by another, the way the action pushes on in increasing waves of activity with the longest left to last. Is there a resolution? All I can say is that at the end of the piece, as the music spreads out, I wanted to give the impression of time slowing down and spreading out. Gathered something of at the end of that piece. I met the Finnish composer Kaija Saariaho some years ago, and I've never forgotten her saying in an almost visionary voice that composers are the masters of time. And I do indeed feel we have the potential to slow down and speed up the way a listener perceives the passing of time. I'm not talking only about how long something appears to last for, but all the feelings that go with this too. We well know that music can have an effect on the speed of our pulse, especially when combined with dancing, and so too music can slow the pace of our metabolism down. But Sarriaho fondly meant, I think, all the endless nuances of how we as composers divide up a portion of time, the relations between strongly directed, goal-oriented time and broken time, between time rushing forward and time that appears smooth or circling or suspended. Time flows variously within us. I sometimes feel locked into clock time, but then my mind runs faster in anticipation of something, or eases into something much slower too. When something's of significance for me, and I really concentrate upon it, I can be surprised how much time has passed. When I'm bored by something, because it appears to go nowhere, time slows to a snail's pace. But if I embrace the very same thing, time can open out exquisitely. The perception of time is greatly affected by our moods and by our own personal and cultural expectations. Music focuses all these things, acts them out, stimulates those very sensations. The American musicologist Carl Berger has compellingly compared Bach's Eternal Time to Mozart's directed Enlightenment One in his book entitled Bach's Circle, Mozart's Arrow. In both the 12-bar blues and a Baroque chaconne, we feel the play between a looped, revolving set of harmonies and striving melodic lines above it. In the 20th century and into the 21st, the relationship between stasis and mobility has gone still further. Debussy was one of the first to start it, as you've heard, with colours and silences freed from progressions. Stravinsky's revolution in rhythm in The Rite of Spring is almost a running on the spot. The early minimalists aim to remove forward direction altogether, chilled out, oriented towards an imaginary east. My slowing down of things isn't quite as chilled. In Roseland, time stills from being cut into discontinuous fragments, but there's still motion within and between them. In Lost Worlds that you've just heard, an impression of unchanging time is only glimpsed, non-directed serenity in the context of human yearning. And even at the end, as you perceive the image of something stretching out, it's also tinged with regret. How so? Because the ending, which you might have heard somehow in there, is a quotation, a reminiscence of something, as it were, coming in from the outside. The Adagietto movement from Mahler's Fifth Symphony, and it disappears as soon as it's recognisable. And it embodies another fundamental aspect for me of how music and time interleave: memory. Music moves forward, but at the same time, every present sound heard is related by the listener, consciously or unconsciously, to past sounds, not just within the piece, but beyond its borders too. So if you did catch the Mahler, it may well have triggered associations outside my piece with your own pasts. The Adagietto takes me straight here. Or equally, you might have felt the Mahler suddenly pulled up from the past and into the present, and all the more aching for its involuntary appearance in contemporary climes. The power of a memory doesn't just come from its content, but also from the way it appears to you, from the relationship between past and present, from the gap between what is and what was, from how we feel something is held in the memory, yet know it is no more. My literary touchstone in this could, of course, be Proust, but my own memory is too ragged for me to feel fully connected to the overflowing Proustian one. No, for me, the master instead is W.G. Sebald. Memory fragmented, memory buried upon memory, or dredged up, layer upon layer, and with a precision in the telling which somehow makes the memories appear all the more elusive. This is a short quotation from Sebald's Austerlitz, and one of the characters, Vera, is recounting her past in Prague. "These days," Vera continued, "the pictures of our excursions together from the Schwarkova through the Lesser Quarter tend to go hand in hand with such reminiscences from my own childhood. When memories come back to you, you sometimes feel as if you were looking at the past through a glass mountain. And now, as I tell you this, if I close my eyes, I see the two of us, as it were, disembodied, or more precisely, reduced to the unnaturally enlarged pupils of our eyes, looking down from the observation platform on the Pechin Hill at the green slopes below." That image of the glass mountain has haunted me ever since I first read it, and it's contributed a lot to my thinking about memory, in particular in terms of outline blur and distance, and especially how distance can change as time passes. So alongside music that involves sudden strong flashes of memory, as in Lost Worlds, I've also written pieces in which there are gradual emergences, and these have often been built around complete or near-complete works of others. Such a piece is Distant Charms, one of a set of 12 piano pieces, which I call On Memory. Distant Charms is based on a work by François Couperin called La Cède du Sort, from his ninth Ode for keyboard, the one who is seducing or being seduced, hence the title of my piece. So here, from murky beginnings of a long-ago past, the memory pushes up bit by bit towards the surface of consciousness, yet still just held back or distorted by a glass mountain. So I'm going to play you now the beginning of Couperin's piece, upon which my piece is based. So at the start of my piece, Couperin is right there, but you can't hear it. It's almost completely submerged by using the pedal to merge the notes, by starting in a region of the piano so full of harmonics that sounds are already quite obscure there, by hinting at the flow of the original music from the past, but blocking it with pauses, with tempo shifts, pulling back, with changes of octave so that the original profile is distorted. Yet as the piece goes on, there's a very gradual move towards something more explicit, a memory rising up. And the last bars of the piece sound quite clearly as the Couperin. notes are in the right order, all flows continuously, yet even here there's one thing wrong, one distortion. It's just too high. The memory has surfaced, but it's higher than it could be if played by a harpsichord, and of course it's changed too by being played on the piano. So even as the memory takes hold, there's also the sense of it being a kind of photographic negative of the past. The memory brings the past back, yet we know it's a kind of illusion too. There's simultaneously a presence and an absence. Time is a slippery thing. If Sebald stands behind me in terms of literature to do with memory, musically speaking, it's Schumann. No composer, I think, has been more attuned to the expression of memory and loss than him. No better example for me than in his song cycle, Frauenliebe und Leben. Singer enraptured with the image of her love, as in a waking dream. But by the end of the cycle, the dream is shattered, the veil is drawn down, and when the melody of the first song returns, it's the piano alone which plays it. The voice is absent. This is Charles Rosen, the American pianist and musicologist, on that final song. There is a gap here that must be filled by the listener. The postlude is a memory, and part of the memory is missing. It has to be recalled, willed to return, as it inevitably is. Schumann has forced the listener to acknowledge the eternal imperfection of memory and to complete the song. The end of the cycle is not a return, but a ghost of a return, a fragment or shadow of the original. It was an extraordinary inspiration in the opening song to withdraw the piano's doubling of the melody at the climax, leaving the woman's voice isolated. In the postlude, to make this moment of the greatest pathos in the opening song disappear is a stroke of genius. In the end, the unexpected void is more affecting than the original melody. I continue to learn enormously from Schumann, what it is to leave things out in music, the power of the altered return, the poignancy of the unfinished. And last year in the chamber work, Sehnsucht, I took a further step in exploring the territory. Gone now are references to the past through direct quotation. Instead, I've tried all the harder to expand my own musical vocabulary to make it all the more inclusive of difference, stretching from the extremely simple and tonal to something rawer in utterance than I've achieved before. Sehnsucht is a richly elusive German word involving striving and longing and also homecoming, with a sense of that home being equally in the future as in the past, and equally unattainable in both temporal directions. The profound ache that that holds doesn't mean we renounce such strivings. It's at the very heart of what drives us on, and it doesn't mean we never quite reach home. We cannot taste snatches of it along the way. In the third bar of my piece, there is such a snatch, which you may not be able to see, but up there, the expression mark that I've put attached to that third bar is to be played with a quivering beauty. It's an impossible direction, yet I think all the more expressive because of the impossibility. Here's the start of the piece now. First, a shudder of an idea, then bar three, and later some of the bright, intense gestures that the piece contains. Plays its significant part in the drama of yearning. But there's a further aspect to its use that has become so important to what I do, and that is to try to find ways to reconceive, rehear, review sounds that we think we already know. Is such a thing possible? The late 18th century poet and philosopher Novalis certainly thought so and had strong reasons for wanting to do this. To romanticize the world is to make us aware of the magic, mystery, and wonder of the world. It is to educate the senses to see the ordinary as extraordinary, the familiar as strange, the mundane as sacred, the finite as infinite. There's so much in that statement, and for me, as relevant for our times as for his, it puts, I hope, my involvement with time and memory into a wider expressive context. Romanticism today can still get a dubious press. It suggests indulgence, excess, falsehood, sentimentality. But as Novalis says, there can be other, very different reasons for the romantic impulse, And for me, the attempt to make music that carries the listener in one way or another beyond the everyday is a major part of my compositional motivation. Splintering continuities to allow newly focused listening, as in Roseland and Lost Worlds, is one way to do this. And in fact, it's again Schumann and other 19th century artists who are my main model here. The romantic fragment is a symbol of human frailty and loss, but also, if perceived as broken off from something larger or a ruin, it points towards the sublime. In Distant Charms, the course of the piece appears to be from mystery to familiarity, from obscurity to clarity. But because of the way the Couperin original eventually emerges, it's heard in some kind of transfigured new light. And in Sehnsucht, it's by setting known tonal objects in unfamiliar contexts that I hope they shine jewel-like, anew, fresh, and even strange. And there's a further, perhaps still more basic reason for using tonality in this way, and that's to do with listening itself. The attitude of hardcore musical modernism focused around such polemical articles as Who Cares If You Listen by the American composer Milton Babbitt has thankfully mostly gone. But still, even if composers now want their music to be widely heard, the stuff of musical modernism, dissonance, and discontinuity remains hard for an audience. My approach is not to discard these things, as you can see and hear, but to look for ways to put them into dramas or expressive places which allow the listener, I hope, to experience them as part of a narrative or longer line. To put extended dissonance in relation to extended consonants. To use perceptually different lengths and flavours of fragments so there is a sense of movement between them, to evoke the feeling of timeless time by placing it in relation to activity. In these ways, I want to lead the listener, taking him or her to new untold places, but beginning from somewhere he or she knows. This could be thought of by some as treating the listener as a child, but far from it. Transcending the ordinary can only be achieved by working through it. And I think of this in another way too. For me, the pieces of the known are the equivalent of a figurative in art, something we recognise in the world. The move towards the unknown is a move into abstraction. And in the hands of some, Rothko in particular for me, the abstract proves itself to be especially powerful precisely because it can be so expressive of internal places that the figurative cannot reach. But I'm, of course, doing this with sound and in time, and so the chance to be able to move from one to the other during a piece's course is what I wish to exploit. And it's not one or the other, it's degrees of abstraction, of release, of intensity. The final piece I want to play you today carries the listener from a very simple place indeed to an especially charged one. The piece has quite unusual origins. It involved working with a choir, the New London Chamber Choir, and scientists researching the DNA of musical aptitude. The choir members had swabs taken of their DNA, and a comparison was made with non-singers to see if a component of the genome could indicate a predilection for musical ability. I took a small part of that specific genome sequence and mapped it onto music. As the headline went at the time, the performers sang their own genes. Perhaps this doesn't sound like a simple origin, but when I took the genome sequence and applied it at first to a limited set of notes, it came out to sound extremely like a piece of plain song, and I gave this most unadorned of materials to a single voice. But the piece is not for a standard choir of four parts, it's for one of 40 parts, as in Tallis's Spem in Allium. And so the multiplication of the initial part came to lead to something rich and strange indeed, especially at the highest climax point of the piece, in which the parts layer upon each other without rhythmic synchronization. Carries the listener from something known and recognisable to a road less travelled. Part of that comes from the sound of one voice bouncing off another and the textural fabric that results. And part of it comes from the way, I hope, the music sounds like it is both moving forward as one part adds on to the next and becomes increasingly directionless the more parts that enter. Or that the river has found its way temporarily to a still pool, not despite, but because of the waters circling within it. Or once again, as if time is slowing down. The American composer Morton Feldman, who's been a big influence on my music, distinguished between time and timing. He wanted to leave behind the conventions of good timing, so that in pure time, sounds all the more would be properly heard and contemplated. My way of doing things is to create moments of this, even sometimes quite long ones, but in the end, as the drama starts up again, so does the need for good timing. Perhaps I'm trying to have my cake and eat it, but it's because I'm searching for a musical expression, for a path towards the transcendent, not a representation of it. And also, if I occasionally allow my musical river to overflow its banks, fundamentally, I'm attached to musical craft and the need to make something that, as it flows, holds together. I started today with the observation that when we talk about music, we easily ignore its temporal nature. But maybe this needs some final refining. Maybe, just as there are so many different kinds of music, there are many different kinds of listening and remembering. Some music, it seems to me, does lose out significantly if we ignore its unfolding in time. Yet other music demands us to hear and recall it as a singularity. A Bach fugue does not work in the same way as a Mozart sonata. Debussy is exactly, as Boulez put it, vitrified improvisation. If we listen to the differently circling layers of Javanese gamelan, or the slow opening of the alap in an Indian rag, or to Terry Riley's standard bearer of minimalism in C, and have been expecting Beethovenian logic, we will be sorely disappointed. But if we accept their kind of time, we will not be bored. We may come to listen all the more acutely, and our souls may settle a little more serenely. For my part, evoking the present as infinite is caught, temporally and emotionally, between looking into the past and projecting into the future. These moments in my music are likely to keep an ache in them, expressing their imminent loss. But we'll see. Maybe as this professorship continues and I gain the wisdom that's supposed to go with the title, I'll yet be able to allow myself to create music freer of tension, even leave Mahler behind. Or perhaps I yet express the tension of now and then still more intensely. It remains to be seen and heard. Thank you very much.